everyone, and welcome to the November 2010 meeting of the Federal Communications Commission. Madam Secretary, would you please introduce our agenda this morning?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning to you and good morning, commissioners. Today's agenda includes three items for your consideration and one presentation. First, you will consider a notice of proposed rulemaking seeking comment on rules to facilitate the most efficient use of the UHF and VHF TV bands. These proposals, an important step toward the agency's spectrum goals as outlined in the National Broadband Plan, would take steps to enable mobile broadband use with spectrum currently reserved for use by TV broadcasters, including through innovations such as channel sharing and generating increased value within the VHF band. Second, you will consider a notice of proposed rulemaking seeking comment on steps to promote innovation and efficiency in spectrum use under Part 5, Experimental Radio Service. For your third item, you will consider a notice of inquiry seeking comment on promoting more intensive and efficient use of the radio spectrum, thereby potentially enabling more effective spectrum management through dynamic spectrum use technologies. Last on your agenda, the Consumer and Governmental Affairs Bureau will present an overview of the 21st Century Communications and Video Accessibility Act and the Commission's implementation plans and demonstrate accessibility technologies. This is your agenda for today. All three items will be presented by the Office of Engineering and Technology. Julia Snapp, Chief of the Office, will give the introduction.
Thank you, Mr. Knapp. Congratulations on your hat trick.
Well, thank you.
Today, three important items. Please go ahead. The floor is yours.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. We'll be presenting three items for your consideration today, each of which serve to advance the Commission's spectrum goals and, as a result, boost the economy and jobs. The first item is a notice of proposed rulemaking that would lay the groundwork for improving efficiencies in the spectrum currently used for TV broadcasting to make more spectrum available for wireless broadband services. Here with me at the table is Alan Stilwell, who's the Deputy Chief of OET, Bill Lake, who's the Chief of the Mass Media Bureau, along with Eloise Gore, who's Associate Chief of the Bureau, and Barbara Kreisman, who is Chief of the Video Division. The item will be presented by Alan Stilwell, but before turning the floor over to Alan, I'd like to extend my thanks to the people who have worked on this item. From Media Bureau, Bill Lake, Eloise Gore, Barbara Kreisman, and Rebecca Hansen, Sean Mayer, Lyle Elder, and Gordon Godfrey. From the Wireless Telecommunications Bureau, Ruth Milkman, John Leibowitz, and Rob Aldifer. From the Office of General Counsel, Austin Schlick, David Horowitz, and Bill Scherer. And aside from Alan and OET, Bruce Romano and Nancy Brooks. Alan will present the item.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. The notice of proposed rulemaking before you would initiate a process to further the Commission's ongoing commitment to addressing America's growing demand for wireless broadband services, spur innovation and investment in wireless broadband systems, and ensure that America leads the global wireless revolution. The notice would take preliminary steps towards making additional spectrum available for wireless broadband from a portion of the spectrum that is currently used for broadcast television. At the same time, the notice recognizes the important benefits served by broadcast television and takes an approach that will help preserve that service as a healthy, viable medium. The notice proposes three actions that are intended to set the underlying regulatory framework to accommodate wireless broadband uses of the TV bands. The proposals in the notice, if adopted, would also provide new options for broadcasters. First, the notice proposes to add new allocations for fixed and land mobile services in the TV bands to be co-primary with the existing broadcasting allocation in those bands. This proposal would make all of the spectrum in the TV bands available for fixed, mobile, and broadcast use, and thereby provide the maximum flexibility for the Commission's planning efforts, including the possibility of auctioning a portion of the spectrum for new broadband services in the future. Second, this notice proposes to establish a framework of rules that would permit two or more television stations to share a single 6 megahertz channel, that is, to operate from the same transmission facilities on the same channel and thereby freeing up one or more of the original channels for use by wireless broadband services. Under this framework, stations entering into channel sharing arrangements would retain their rights to mandatory carriage on cable and DBS systems. The proposed sharing rules would neither increase nor decrease the carriage rights of any broadcaster on any type of multiple video distribution system. Finally, the notice proposes to create value for television viewers and broadcasters by increasing the utility of the VHF bands for the operation of television services. The goal in this initiative is to resolve digital broadcast reception problems in the VHF bands. The notice specifically proposes to increase the maximum power allowed for VHF stations, subject to avoidance of interference to other services, and to establish minimum performance standards for indoor antennas. These actions will lay the groundwork for the goal set in the National Broadband Plan to make available up to 120 megahertz from the broadcast television bands for new wireless broadband services. They would pave the way for future actions by which the Commission could propose plans for recovery of TV spectrum, including service, licensing, and auction rules for new wireless broadband operators. The staff recommends adoption of this item and requests editorial privileges. Thank you.
Alan, thank you. Consistent with our goals of spectrum efficiency and efficient presentation on an important topic. We will hear comments from the bench. Commissioner Copps.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I approach this notice with cautious optimism as we begin to contemplate spectrum innovation and how to make the best use of the limited spectrum we have. I agree that we need to act in a strong, forward-looking manner to realize the tremendous promise of wireless broadband. There are a number of ways to help accomplish this, but we are going to be called upon to think very creatively and outside the proverbial box in order to make it a success. I think of this item as contingency planning for the better allocation of spectrum, and that applies to the concept of channel sharing. We don't yet know whether legislative action or economic conditions will allow for implementation of the full range of spectrum recommendations put forth in the National Broadband Plan. But we do know that we need to be smarter about spectrum utilization and that we need to maximize spectrum performance so that it may better serve the many communications needs of the American people. I am, of course, mightily interested in the future of broadcasting. At the outset, I commend the notice's recognition of the public value that free-to-all over-the-air television can bring to America's citizens. Many broadcasters have worked hard to turn this value into reality. I believe in the power of broadcasting and the potential for broadcasters not only to survive, but to thrive if they will but recognize their strengths and the advantages that localism and the public-spirited administration of the airwaves bring to them. It's an advantage that not all, in fact, not nearly enough, broadcasters have pursued. It is no secret that I have been disappointed that so much of the spectrum dividend that accrued to broadcasters as a result of the DTV transition goes dramatically underutilized. I am not interested in pushing broadcasters somewhere else or in discouraging their enhanced public interest stewardship of the airwaves, but public interest multicasting remains all too often a concept and not a reality. I speak only for myself in saying that had this spectrum been put to such positive use as I have just discussed, I would have little interest in contemplating other uses of it. But here we are, trying to divine how scarce and sometimes underutilized spectrum can best serve consumers and citizens. Between now and such time as channel sharing and incentive auctions and all the rest come our way, maybe more broadcasters will come to see the wisdom of harvesting greater public benefits from the spectrum they are licensed to use. One of the greatest challenges facing us as we work to identify spectrum for wireless broadband and other uses is to make sure that we have a comprehensive understanding of the current spectrum landscape. Surely our future success will depend not only on an understanding of our current allocations and assignments, but also on its actual use. That's why I am so glad that we continue to make progress on our spectrum dashboard, which will require ongoing commitment and resources to achieve its full potential. I know from my experience during the digital TV transition that major changes in spectrum use can raise many issues, some unforeseen, and that they require concerted outreach to and work with both consumers and industry. Consumers generally don't concern themselves much about the arcane details of spectrum allocation, nor should they have to. But they do rightly care that when they turn on a TV or make a call on a smartphone, it works. And so we must begin a balancing act, weighing the needs and requirements of today and tomorrow. I am pleased that we asked some difficult questions in this notice. We need to understand the regulatory framework under which channel sharing would be allowed, the technical implications for broadcasters and viewers, and how any changes would affect over-the-air broadcasting. We also examine ways to improve TV reception in the VHF spectrum. This latter will not be easy, believe me. We looked everywhere we could, under every rock and around every corner during the TV transition, and real remedies were few and far between. Let's hope the months ahead lead us to some genuine innovation. We do seem to have a consensus that some considerable new amount of spectrum will be required in the wireless world. Without additional spectrum, wireless consumers could face degraded service and/or higher prices. This concerns me. But it also concerns me that without other safeguards, auctioning off massive amounts of spectrum to incumbent wireless providers may not necessarily result in more consumer-friendly pricing or service. Additional spectrum is, to be sure, an important part of the wireless solution. The whole solution, it isn't. And I suppose that's the difference between physical spectrum and spectrum policy. So this is a good and necessary item. We are teeing up questions that need to be answered, and if there are questions we don't ask, I hope commenters will answer them anyhow. We'll all pay attention, I guarantee you that. Thank you to Julie Knapp and the team at the Office of Engineering and Technology for the thorough job they did on a very complicated item. Their work continues to amaze me. And thanks to all of the other bears who cooperated in bringing this to us. Thank you.
Commissioner Cobbs, thank you very much. Commissioner McDowell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. With this notice, we launched one key initiative in the Commission's larger ongoing quest to make the most productive use of our nation's spectrum resources. The issue of future uses within the television broadcast band is only part of our overall policy focus on spectrum issues, but it may be the most prominent one. As we go forward in this proceeding, I will remain mindful of the significant public interest benefits that broadcasters deliver. I also understand the need to ensure that any new rules for allowing more flexible uses within the TV band must leave incumbent broadcast licensees with viable opportunities to experiment with their own mix of wireless services, including, but not limited to, traditional broadcasting. At the same time, I'm excited about the prospects of exploring options for wireless broadband services within the frequencies currently devoted to over-the-air television. Although this notice directs much of its attention to the concept of voluntary channel sharing among broadcasters, I have not reached any conclusion as to whether that approach is the best possible option for getting the most out of the TV band. I would like I would like commenters to tell us more about the feasibility of alternatives that may be used in lieu of or in conjunction with channel sharing. For example, broadcasters already are empowered under Section 336 of the Communications Act to offer a flexible range of ancillary or supplemental wireless services in addition to their primary broadcast program stream. I've been a longtime proponent of encouraging broadcasters to lease some of their spectrum for wireless broadband purposes, and now is the time to dig into this concept seriously. How would this approach work in the context of increasing the availability of wireless broadband? What are the technical issues as well as the business feasibility issues? Would this approach be a faster means of getting more spectrum for broadband into the marketplace than the channel sharing concept? What are the relative strengths and weaknesses of the plan for channel sharing, eventual spectrum clearing, and repacking, versus the concept of allowing broadcasting and broadband uses to be interwoven throughout the existing TV band? I will also review with great interest the submissions we receive on the topic of potential technical improvements for digital broadcasting on VHF channels. as one of the two remaining veteran commissioners of the digital television transition and sitting next to the director of NTIA at the time, I have not forgotten the difficult and unanticipated challenges that we and broadcasters on those channels faced at the time of the analog shutoff. Both industry and FCC engineers scrambled throughout the spring and summer of 2009 to try to overcome interference and other reception problems associated with VHF channels. What had been prime real estate in the days of analog broadcasting sometimes became a rough neighborhood in the new digital era. Before the Commission takes action that might lead to more broadcasters moving back into those channels, I will want to fully understand the ramifications of such a decision. And I also thank the members of OET and the Media Bureau and everyone involved in working on this notice. It's terrific. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Clyburn.
Thank you. I strongly support efforts to encourage more efficient use of all spectrum, including broadcast spectrum. So if certain broadcasters are underutilizing the spectrum we have licensed to them, and for those who are willing to do so on a voluntary basis, I am supportive of any recovery mechanism that would best benefit the public interest. Additionally, I endorse actions that give all of our licensees more flexibility, which will allow for more innovation and competition that will ultimately benefit consumers. We also have, however, a significant obligation to protect the important public interest that over-the-air broadcast TV provides for our nation. As we progress through this and other proceedings related to the National Broadband Plan's recommendation for reallocating 120 megahertz of broadcast spectrum for broadband services, we should carefully study the possible impact that removing broadcast spectrum could have on all consumers and local communities. But I cannot stress enough, we must pay close attention, careful attention, to those who are the most vulnerable to the loss of broadcast television. We learned during the DTV transition that a large number of Americans, such as seniors and the very poor, continue to rely on broadcast TV to stay informed. Those communities that heavily depend on broadcast programming should not have to sacrifice those benefits in order for our nation to attain wireless broadband services. I encourage our staff to work closely with broadcasters and consumer advocates so that we arrive at a long-term solution that properly balances both of these important interests. I also wish to thank all of those who work so hard on this item. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Commissioner Baker.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. This proceeding is the beginning of a process to evaluate the best means to modernize our spectrum rules for the TV bands. This should be a collaborative process, and we should not begin with a preconceived end state or assumptions about particular future uses. Over-the-air broadcasters, mobile broadband providers, and other innovators need the opportunity to help craft rules that will serve the public interest and provide for a robust future for broadcasting and broadband. I believe strongly that we cannot lock in today's technology or business plan for any spectrum user, whether it be broadcast or broadband. Central to that principle, we should always aim to provide a future path for innovation and investment, and I'm hopeful we can achieve the proper balance in this proceeding. A path focused on future opportunity necessarily requires all stakeholders to demonstrate a willingness to question the status quo and to work cooperatively. We should start every discussion of the TV bands with the recognition that it has only been a year and 5 months since full power broadcasters completed their transition to digital. Any successful transition of additional portion of the TV bands to mobile broadband should be a consensus-driven process. To facilitate it, we should encourage new technology and innovation in, and more broadly, new thinking about how broadcasters and broadband providers coexist. This notice takes a number of steps to optimize spectrum usage in the TV bands and provide broadcasters with greater flexibility in how spectrum is used, a hallmark for our modern spectrum policy across bands. To that end, I support the Commission's effort to add allocations for fixed and mobile services in the UHF and VHF bands. Our overall flexible approach is also evident in the fact that the item does not specify a future band plan for recovered spectrum. I also support proposals to improve operating conditions in the VHF band. As we all know, there were real consequences for reception of VHF signals as a result of the DTV transition. I accept that this item represents an initial step in updating our TV band rules. Significant and fundamental issues are deferred. In the future, there needs to be a fulsome discussion on additional innovative proposals to address sharing of broadband and broadcast in the TV bands, including the possibility of a transition from MPEG-2 to MPEG-4, the adoption of a more cellularized broadcast system, or a transition from ATSC to OFDM technologies. These are by no means the only potential approaches and may have their own weaknesses and strengths. And in all fairness, we should also ask additional questions about the future applicability of public interest obligations on broadcast licensees. If the TV bands are to shift towards a more flexible spectrum model, it is only right to ask whether those use restrictions should also be revisited. We should also acknowledge that we need to partner with and have to have a good relationship with Congress to give us the tools to potentially that are potentially necessary to effectuate our policy decisions. In particular, I'm hopeful that Congress will soon provide the Commission with the authority to conduct incentive auctions, as well as other tools to manage spectrum more effectively. These tools can help the Commission offer win-win situations to incumbent and new users of spectrum. Importantly, these are not tools nor an approach that should be limited to the TV bands. Indeed, it is critical that we stress that this proceeding is part of a much broader, overreaching, cross-governmental spectrum reform effort to ensure our nation's long-term competitiveness and a bright future for the spectrum-hungry mobile broadband services. As we fully consider the future of the TV bands, we should also work to avoid the mistakes of the past, where the practical impact of allocations in one band had a ripple effect across other users or inhibited future efforts. In the TV bands, these challenges caused by wireless microphones are the ones that have been most discussed, but the issues surrounding TV channel 51 warrant greater focus. Channel 51 is adjacent to the lower block A in the 700 megahertz. The presence of high-power broadcast operations in many communities may foreclose the opportunity to build out a broadband offering in the 700 megahertz. I appreciate that we ask questions directly about that issue here, and more generally, we seek comment on how to best avoid such situations, particularly as it relates to channel 37 and the uppermost channel dedicated to over-the-air broadcasting. If we view the TV bands and our spectrum policy more comprehensively, we can avoid some of these pitfalls going forward. We also cannot ignore the unintended consequences of our prior actions. We need to address existing impediments to investment, like the Channel 51 issue, in an equitable and expedited manner. I look forward to addressing all of these challenges with my fellow commissioners. Many thanks to the staff who worked so hard on this item over Thanksgiving. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Baker. This item is the first of three the Commission is considering today that will help meet our nation's need for cutting-edge wireless services and technologies for the 21st century, helping spur our economy and create jobs. One way to think of spectrum is as invisible infrastructure. Though you can't see it, spectrum is the backbone of our mobile communications infrastructure and so is essential to one of the most robust and promising sectors of our economy. We are at an inflection point with our invisible infrastructure. The explosive growth in mobile communications threatens to outpace the infrastructure on which it relies. I've said this before, but it bears repeating an emphasis. If we don't act to update our spectrum policies for the 21st century, we're going to run into a wall, a spectrum crunch, that will stifle American innovation and economic growth and cost us the opportunity to lead the world in mobile communications. The spectrum crunch also threatens to create millions of dissatisfied mobile consumers who, if we don't tackle this challenge, we'll be forced to choose between poor service and higher prices. Dropped mobile internet connections won't be any less frustrating than dropped calls. As we outlined in the National Broadband Plan and more recently in our FCC Spectrum Summit, we have a two-pronged plan for bridging the gap between spectrum supply and demand. First, we'll pursue policies to drive the most efficient and flexible use of spectrum. Second, we'll seek to bring market forces to bands of spectrum where markets currently aren't given the opportunity to work. this item advances both goals. It starts what I hope will become a landmark rulemaking to bring efficiency to the use of our TV broadcast spectrum, and it lays essential groundwork for market-based policies in the form of voluntary incentive auctions, which I strongly hope Congress authorizes in the near future. The roughly 300 megahertz of spectrum in the TV bands is among the most robust available. Some people call it beachfront property. The transition to digital made it possible to transmit over-the-air broadcast programming using less spectrum than before. While some stations are seizing the opportunity to offer multicast streams or mobile TV that serve the public interest, and I commend them, others are not. We might think of the steady stream of broadcast TV transmissions as trains with a fixed number of boxcars delivering digital content. But many of the boxcars now are empty. The spectrum is too valuable and our spectrum needs too great for it to be used inefficiently in this manner, especially given that less than 10% of Americans receive broadcast television only through over-the-air spectrum signals, itself a significant inefficiency. Yet our rules currently don't permit certain types of efficient use, like channel sharing. To stick with the metaphor, to which I'm indebted to my colleague Julie Knapp, channel sharing would allow two or more TV stations to fill the boxcars on a train of spectrum. Today's rulemaking proposes rules for voluntary channel sharing, increased flexibility in the broadcast allocations, adjustments to VHF power. In so doing, we lay important groundwork for voluntary incentive auctions in the broadcast TV band. Our goal is to be ready to move quickly in the event that Congress authorizes incentive auctions. I believe that moving forward with incentive auctions is vital to our economy and to American consumers. By bringing market forces to broadcast spectrum, it would free up airwaves for mobile broadband, drive private investment, enhance our global competitiveness, and lead to improved service for consumers. It would also yield significant revenue for the Treasury. It is fair to broadcasters, providing additional optionality, a win-win, as Commissioner Baker put it, while recognizing broadcasters' important ongoing obligation to serve the public interest and the needs of viewers who continue to rely only on over-the-air broadcasting. The action we take today is our first formal step to set the stage for incentive auctions. It's perhaps reminiscent of an action taken more than 20 years ago at the Commission, when the FCC started a process to provide for digital television. While it wasn't headline news at the time, it ultimately led to the emergence of a new generation of TV technology and freed more than 100 megahertz of spectrum that is about to usher in fourth generation or 4G wireless services and technologies and new broadband services for public safety. We know it won't be easy to free up spectrum for mobile broadband from the existing TV band. Neither was the process that led to the DTV transition and the resulting freeing of spectrum. Yet, it is at least as necessary as the process that began more than 20 years ago. And because of how fast our global competitors are moving, it's essential that we move rapidly. We don't have anywhere close to 20 years this time. We can't afford to fall behind, and that's why today we take this important step to begin the process of freeing up a significant amount of broadcast TV spectrum for mobile broadband. I thank Julie and everyone who participated in the presentation and the development of this item at OET, the Wireless Bureau, the Media Bureau, OGC. This item is a great example of how we can achieve a great product in an important area by close collaboration among bureaus and offices. And I thank each of my colleagues on the commission and their staffs for working closely together on this item. With that, are we proceeding? We are proceeding to a vote at this point. So unless there's more discussion, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. The ayes have it. So ordered, and the request for editorial privileges is granted. Thank you. Madam Secretary, please announce the next item on the agenda.
Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, the second and third items on your agenda will be presented together. Item 2 on your agenda is entitled Promoting Expanded Opportunities for Radio Experimentation and market studies under Part 5 of the Commission's rules and streamlining other related rules, 2006 Biennial Review of Telecommunications Regulations. Item 3 on your agenda is entitled Promoting More Efficient Use of Spectrum Through Dynamic Spectrum Use Technologies, and the Wireless Telecommunications Bureau will join the Office of Engineering and Technology in presenting this item.
Thank you. Mr. Knapp, do you have the floor again?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's my pleasure to present for your consideration two items to spur investment in wireless technology and to aid our economy by encouraging research and development of new products and services and by finding ways to increase access to our scarce spectrum resources. The first item is a notice of proposed rulemaking that proposes an overhaul of our experimental licensing program to make it easier for places such as universities, research institutions, healthcare institutions, and other organizations to develop and study new wireless technologies. The second item is a notice of inquiry on dynamic spectrum access, which was prepared jointly with the Wireless Telecommunications Bureau. The item seeks to create value from spectrum that lies fallow much of the time by opening it up to new services and devices that use dynamic spectrum access techniques. The item also explores how we might modify our secondary market rules to further encourage development and use of services based on dynamic spectrum access. The two items will be presented by Ira Keltz, who's Deputy Chief of OET. Also here with us at the table are Ruth Milkman, who is the Chief of the Wireless Telecommunications Bureau, and Paul Murray, who is Assistant Bureau Chief. Before presenting the item, allow me to take a moment to thank the many people who helped prepare these items. As I was looking at the list, I was reminded of we get by with a little help from our friends. In our case, we get by with a lot of help from our friends. For the experimental item, from the Wireless Bureau, Ruth Milkman, Paul Murray, Roger Noel, and Tom Derringe, Margie Wiener, and Gary Michaels. From the Media Bureau, John Wong, Wayne McKee, Susan Crawford, Gordon Godfrey, Kevin Harding, and Jim Bradshaw. From the General Counsel's Office, David Horowitz and Steve Spaeth. From the Office of Strategic Planning, on our Chief Technologist, Doug Sicker. And from OET, in addition to Ira, Bruce Romano, Jerry Matisse, Jameson Prime, Nicholas Orris, James Miller, Jim Bertle, Anthony Serafini, Doug Young, Ben Jafari, Rashmi Doshi, and Nancy Brooks. I still have more names. For the dynamic spectrum item, from the Wireless Bureau, Ruth Milkman, Paul Murray, Gary Michaels, Margie Wiener, and Mary Booker. From the Office of Strategic Planning, Doug Sicker and Stuart Benjamin. And from OET, again, it was Ira, Bruce Romano, Jerry Matisse, Rod Small, and Nicholas Oros. Ira will now present the item.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. We have two items before you that will promote and facilitate innovation in communications technology. A notice of proposed rulemaking that seeks to promote this innovation by updating the Commission's experimental radio service rules, and a notice of inquiry that examines how advanced radio technologies and new models of spectrum management techniques can advance innovation to increase and use and stretch the capacity of our valuable spectrum resource. Many innovative ideas that have found widespread use by the public and in all sectors of the economy can be traced back to ideas and inspirations developed under experimental radio licenses. Examples include the development of Wi-Fi and the CDMA technology found in today's 3G systems, as well as the LTE and WiMAX technology powering the latest high-tech devices. The experimental radio service has also been instrumental in fostering developments in cutting-edge medical devices, such as implantable monitoring devices and the camera in a pill that allows physicians to non-invasively and painlessly gather and examine high-resolution images of internal organs. To ensure that the United States remains at the forefront of innovation, we now propose to accelerate the rate at which these ideas transform from prototypes to consumer devices and services by providing more flexibility to researchers and developers. Under our existing rules, each experimental program must be described and approved by the Commission, and if researchers make discoveries that necessitate changes in operating authority, they must seek prior approval for modification of their license. We now propose to create a new type of experimental license, the program license. These licenses would provide broad authority for experimentation over a wide variety of frequencies and a range of operating parameters without the need to obtain prior authorization before conducting individual experiments. Specifically, we propose to create three types of program licenses. The first would be available to universities and national laboratories so that they can leverage their vast resources and expertise in basic research to bring about innovation. Second, we propose to create an innovation zone program license where researchers could conduct tests in specified geographic locations with pre-authorized boundary conditions. And third, we propose to create a medical program license that would be available to qualified hospitals, Veterans Administration facilities, and other medical institutions to foster advancements in technologies that can improve patient care and save lives. We also propose to broaden opportunities for market trials to provide greater opportunities for equipment manufacturers and service providers to conduct product development and market trials. The proposed rules will also allow market trials to more fully engage consumers so developers can better meet their needs. The notice also proposes to promote greater overall experimentation by consolidating, streamlining, and making targeted modifications to our existing rules and procedures. Collectively, the rule changes proposed in the notice will spark innovation and promote robust experimentation. Additionally, we believe that the proposals for the experimental radio service will provide new opportunities for innovators to examine ways that dynamic spectrum access technologies, including cognitive or opportunistic radio technologies, can help address the challenge posed by the looming spectrum crunch by enabling more efficient usage of our nation's precious spectrum resource. We explore these latter themes in greater detail in the Notice of Inquiry, which seeks to promote and facilitate wireless innovation. Specifically, the inquiry seeks comment on ways in which dynamic spectrum access radios and techniques can promote more intensive and efficient use of spectrum. It seeks information on the development of spectrum sensing and other dynamic spectrum sharing capabilities and techniques that can identify temporarily unused spectrum. The inquiry also requests information on how the Commission can promote the development of these technologies, such as by establishing dynamic access radio test beds, and how dynamic radios and spectrum management techniques may be deployed in the future for use on both a licensed and an unlicensed basis. Additionally, the inquiry examines whether the database access model recently applied to unlicensed television band devices in the TV whitespace proceeding might be deployed in other spectrum bands. It seeks information on what bands might be good candidates for dynamic spectrum access use. For example, spectrum used under flexible use licenses, spectrum held by the commission because licenses did not receive the necessary bids at auction or was returned, bands in rural areas, or other lightly used bands. The inquiry also asks whether real-time spectrum monitoring could be used to identify candidate bands for dynamic spectrum use. Further, the inquiry seeks comment on how spectrum used through secondary market arrangements could employ dynamic spectrum access radios and techniques to incentivize efficient spectrum use. We note that licensees and spectrum lessees already have wide latitude to enter into these types of arrangements and ask whether, as further improvements are made in dynamic spectrum access technologies and techniques, there are additional steps that the Commission should take to facilitate dynamic spectrum leasing or private commons arrangements. Finally, the inquiry asks whether there are additional steps that the Commission should take to improve its online spectrum dashboard to facilitate more efficient use of spectrum through dynamic spectrum access technologies. We believe that the proposed rule changes, as well as the results of our inquiry, will result in advancements in devices and services available to the American public and lead to greater spectrum efficiency over the long term, thereby promoting economic growth, jobs, global competitiveness, and new and improved services for all Americans. The office recommends adoption of the Notice of Proposed Rulemaking and the Notice of Inquiry, and we request editorial privileges. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Commissioner Cobbs?
Thank you. Today's meeting is all about maximizing the power and the opportunity and the efficiency of our public spectrum resource. The demand for spectrum, as we have all said, has never been greater, and we all know that the laws of physics prevent us from being able to create more of this finite resource. That said, even as we look to free up existing spectrum to meet the needs for wireless broadband, We can and should explore ways to make more dynamic and opportunistic use of the spectrum that we have. Given the technology breakthroughs I have been privileged to witness over nearly a decade here at the Commission, I am a strong believer in the creative power of spectrum engineers and innovators, both inside and outside the agency, to help us use our spectrum resource more intensively and efficiently. We need to hear from these experts as we move forward with our notice of inquiry, making sure we have a complete picture of the dynamic spectrum access tools available and doing what we can to encourage their development and use. We also propose today much-needed improvements to our system for spectrum experimentation and a separate notice of proposed rulemaking. Many of you have heard my not infrequent exhortations on the need to do more to encourage research and development in this country in order to ensure America's going forward global competitiveness. Today we make some concrete proposals to advance on that front. We propose to broaden experimental research authorizations for qualified academic and research institutions to afford them greater opportunities to design and implement experiments without the burdens of getting pre-approval each and every time. In a similar vein, we seek to create innovation zones for experimentation that would allow innovators greater flexibility to conduct and modify their spectrum experiments. Nowhere is the potential for RF innovation more exciting than in the area of promoting advances in healthcare technology, whether restoring mobility to paralyzed limbs or creating advanced body sensor networks. We therefore propose to create a new medical experimental program for hospitals and other healthcare institutions supervised in conjunction with the U.S. Food and Drug Administration. Over the years, our experimental radio service program has been a tool that innovators have used to test new and exciting services, many of which are now taken for granted. The improvements we propose today look to build upon that success. One additional comment, you mentioned the utilization of perhaps expanded secondary markets techniques or procedures here, and I look forward to a record on that, and I would hope that as part of what follows, we would really compile the record that we have here and whatever other we can get, just to see overall. I'd like to really have a feel for how secondary markets have served the goals we have here at the Commission, to what extent they are meeting the potential that we believe they have. And I think as we design the future, we need to understand exactly where we are with regard to the procedures we put in place some years ago. Thank you again to Julie and his truly excellent team, and to Ruth Milkman. You mentioned the innovation zone. We obviously have our own little innovation zone right here at the FCC, and we're mighty proud of that. So I look forward to working with you and all of my distinguished colleagues to bring these proceedings to a sound and expeditious proceeding, because I think the country can reap solid benefits from such action, help us regain competitiveness, and that translates into jobs in the global economy. So thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Commissioner McDowell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm delighted to support both of these items today, and I do want to thank the teams at OET and the Wireless Bureau and the armies that stand behind the people sitting at the table today. We know that none of this would be possible without their dedication and talent, and the work has been fantastic. The American wireless marketplace is dynamic and explosive. It is a world leader in innovation and competition. And it certainly offers one of the brightest rays of growth and opportunity in the American economy. Given this context, I'm pleased that we are starting to do the heavy lifting today to undertake longer-term spectrum planning. As always, I look forward to working with Chairman Jenikowski and all of my colleagues here to begin the process of putting more spectrum into the hands of American consumers. The Notice of Proposed Rulemaking today seeks comments on new ideas to promote innovation and efficiency in spectrum use in our Part 5 Experimental Radio Service, ERS, rules. Our ERS program is a wonderful example of success, as evidenced by the variety of new technologies begun as experiments and subsequently deployed as valuable services relied upon by American consumers every day. These successes include the Personal Communication Service, air-to-ground communications, and new life-changing medical devices, just to name a few. As an overarching matter, I hope our updated rules will adhere to the Commission's more recent flexible use policy. old-style command and control and prescriptive rules not only hamper creative entrepreneurs who are in the best position to understand and satisfy consumer demands, they cause spectral inefficiencies as well. With respect to our notice of inquiry regarding ways to encourage dynamic spectrum use, I have long emphasized that spectral efficiency and seeking new ideas for dynamic uses are crucial in light of the realities that are shaping America's wireless future. When it comes to resolving the spectrum crunch issue, in practical terms, even if we could identify 500 megahertz of quality spectrum to reallocate today, the better part of a decade would pass by before we could write proposed auction rules and band plans, analyze public comment, adopt rules, hold an auction, collect the proceeds, clear the bands, and watch carriers build out and then turn on their networks for their customers. So in the meantime, helping innovators create and deploy new technologies to enhance more efficient use of the airwaves has to be a top priority for all of us. While we sort through the complex issues associated with freeing up more spectrum for the longer term, I look forward to learning more about technologies that will allow wireless providers to take better advantage of the immediate fixes already available in the marketplace. These include more robust deployment of enhanced antenna systems, improved development, testing, and rollout of creative technologies such as cognitive radios, and heightened consideration of the use of femtocells. And by the way, there's a terrific article outlining some of these in today's Washington Post by Jim Giles. Each of these technological options augments capacity and coverage, which is especially important for data and multimedia transmissions. We are at the very beginning of what will surely be a lengthy and complicated process. I look forward to giving these and other issues the careful and thoughtful consideration they deserve, and I thank the chairman for bringing forth these issues today.
Commissioner Clyburn.
I commend the chairman for his leadership in promoting the policies put forth in these companion items. If our nation wants to compete more effectively, we must encourage greater research and development and more efficient spectrum use. Such R&D is not only necessary for the advancement of monumental communications innovations, such as the Internet and the World Wide Web, but it is also critically important to the success of individual businesses and to our overall national economy. A White House study conducted in September of 2009 found that research and development is one of the most important pillars in building a foundation for an economy that could create jobs and drive sustainable growth. All of the initiatives in the experimental license NPRM encourage greater R&D, which will enable individual entities to do more with their experimental authorizations, facilitate collaboration among industry and academics, and streamline rules. The two initiatives I find particularly noteworthy are the research and medical program experimental radio licenses. Universities and nonprofit research institutions have proven they deserve the enhanced experimental authorizations, reduced oversight, and streamlined application process that the research program license would give. For example, using experimental licenses, research institutions have not only developed ultra-fast 1 gigabit per second research and educational broadband networks, but they have also demonstrated public service leadership by advocating that we help connect those communities or those networks to anchor institutions in low-income communities. This recommendation can lead to important short-term and long-term economic benefits. Community connection projects are, by their nature, job-intensive. So connecting these research and education networks to low-income communities can lead to immediate job creation and investment opportunities. For instance, Rutgers University reports that the Global Environment for Network Innovations Project, or GENI, which involves 29 universities, has created hundreds of jobs in New Jersey alone. The National Broadband Plan also explained how Case Western University's project to connect its ultra-fast 1 gigabit per second network to homes, schools, libraries, and museums in a low-income community in Cleveland, Ohio, is creating jobs. This project is also leading to software and service development for environmental efficiency, health, and many other applications. These are just a few examples of why we should do as much as we can, as quickly as we can, to encourage universities and research institutions to engage in more research and development of communications technologies. Designing the medical program experimental authorization to promote more test bed facilities for new wireless medical devices could speed the development of important achievements in healthcare. I thank the Food and Drug Administration and the American Society for Healthcare Engineering for collaborating with us on this initiative. The item encourages researchers and physicians to work with Veterans Affairs facilities and military services early in the development of these new devices, I am pleased to see. Our wounded warriors have made great sacrifice in defense of our nation, and we owe it to them to create an environment that can lead to faster medical breakthroughs and help them make the best of their return to civilian life. The medical program experimental license could also accelerate innovations in telemedicine to further empower both doctors and patients. Advances in video technology and medical broadband applications are allowing physicians to collaborate with their colleagues across the globe in real time on difficult cases. For those suffering from long-term and chronic illnesses, remote patient monitoring offers greater mobility and independence. Our agency should continue to promote technologies and policies that will give those in greatest need of medical care more flexibility in finding the right treatment for them. The scholarship in today's notice of inquiry on dynamic spectrum use technologies also sends a proper message that we must encourage more efficient use of spectrum. The notice recognizes that to best advance these technologies, the Commission must have a clear understanding of how the various parts of the spectrum are being used today. The item then asks detailed technical questions to ensure that we have a comprehensive record on the latest developments in dynamic spectrum technologies. In promoting flexible use policies, such as the leasing of licensed spectrum through the secondary market, the notice presents a cogent analysis of the possible techniques our policies already permit. I thank Doug Sicker, Julie Knapp, one of my favorites, and the other technology evangelists in the Office of Engineering and Technology, the Office of General Counsel, another favorite, and the Wireless Telecommunications Bureau, again, another favorite, for their hard work on these items. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Commissioner Baker.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Everybody's my favorite, too. This holiday season kicks off a new cycle of fundamental change in the wireless device market. Consumers everywhere, especially in my house, are choosing new powerful smartphones. Gartner reports that worldwide smartphone sales grew 96% from the third quarter last year, and SNL Kagan projects smartphones accounting for 30% of overall mobile phone subscriptions by the fourth quarter of 2010 in the United States. Moreover, tablets that use hundreds of times more data than even the most advanced smartphones may well be the stars of this year's giving season. In fact, yesterday's Wall Street Journal cites a recent ChangeWave research survey that found that 9% of holiday shoppers plan to buy an iPad in the next 90 days. I already bought mine. I have little doubt that whether smartphone or tablet, these devices will challenge networks as much as they will delight their owners. I'm convinced that our efforts to find additional spectrum to power these devices and all those that are going to follow constitute only half the battle to meet the dramatically exploding needs of this country's wireless consumers. We also must promote greater innovation to help use the spectrum that we have today and the spectrum that we will allocate tomorrow as efficiently as possible. The two items that we are considering today are a good place to start. In fact, the innovation that they will support may well provide the tools we will need to unlock the full potential in the TV broadcast bands. I'm excited about today's item for expanding opportunities for radio experimentation. I'm a firm believer that we need to support research and development efforts whenever and however we can. Making it easier and more straightforward to conduct real-world research is a natural and straightforward task that we can take. Our action today offers practical support to our nation's inventors by enhancing their ability to test their theories and innovations and streamlining the procedures they must follow to do so. This should help shorten the innovation cycle, which will benefit consumers and operators across the country by reducing the time it will take to get new devices to market. It will also help maintain our country's leadership in the development of wireless technologies, applications, and services. Dynamic spectrum access is thought by many to be a key technological advance that can substantially improve the way spectrum is used for both commercial and non-commercial services. It is an area in where the Department of Defense has shown great leadership and innovation over the years. However, it's proven difficult to apply the research and development in the area of dynamic spectrum access to commercial radio systems. Technical issues have been too complex and costs have been too high. It is my hope that in issuing the NOI on dynamic spectrum access, we can focus our collective attention on what it will take to overcome these challenges. If we are successful, dynamic spectrum access technologies could become one of the go-to tools operators can rely on to more efficiently manage their commercial spectrum resources. Coupled with an enhanced spectrum dashboard and potentially other ways to get information available to spectrum to prospective users, dynamic spectrum access might foster secondary markets for short-term or spot spectrum transactions, which is another potentially useful way to manage congestion. So I join in thanking the army of people that worked on this. You guys are great. You did this in an innovative and rapid way, and we're grateful to you.
Thank you, Commissioner Baker. I have to say those were as excellent a set of statements as I remember, and I think to the team, I would say that you've brought out the enthusiastic geek in all of us, and also the shared commitment that we have, each of the commissioners and the staff, with respect to our fundamental responsibilities when it comes to spectrum, recognizing how important that is, how important the opportunity is for the country, both on the economic side, on the health side, I couldn't be more appreciative of the work on this, and I particularly enjoyed my interactions with the team, as you know, as we've developed these items. We are a commission that's committed to a robust spectrum agenda. We've been working hard at this for quite some time. Earlier this year, thanks to some of the people on the panel right now, we unleashed spectrum, recovered spectrum, or freed up spectrum in the WCS band, 25 megahertz. We took an important step that I'm looking forward to conclude with respect to bringing additional flexibility to mobile satellite service spectrum, an additional 90 megahertz. We, for the first time in 25 years, freed up spectrum below 5 gigahertz for unlicensed use, launching a new platform for innovation that we hope will lead to new products and services as significant as Wi-Fi, which is one of the innovations that came out of the last major increase release of unlicensed spectrum. What we've been calling Super Wi-Fi, one of the applications that we expect to see coming from our newly released White Spaces spectrum, has been helped and accelerated by FCC experimental licenses. So let me address the first of the two items that you've presented. Wi-Fi, Super Wi-Fi, new potentially life-saving anti-collision systems in cars. You may have seen the TV ads. This technology requires spectrum, and it was developed using an FCC experimental license. We've heard that experimental licenses have also played an essential role in the development of life-saving medical devices. I'm very pleased that today we take concrete steps to improve and expand our experimental licensing program. We're proposing, for example, to ease testing restrictions on universities, research organizations, and other institutions that are developing new services and devices that utilize spectrum. We propose innovation zone licenses. We propose a new program to speed the development of new health-related devices that rely on spectrum. One of the most exciting areas for investment and innovation and for improving healthcare and reducing healthcare costs. Our goal is to accelerate innovation through experimental licensing to reduce the time for an idea to get from the lab to the market. A more extensive experimental licensing program would also help the FCC make smarter, faster decisions, particularly when it comes to interference issues, an important responsibility, by giving us on-the-ground intelligence on interference questions and insight into the development of new cutting-edge technologies. Encouraging research and development is vital to our objective of making the U.S. the spawning ground globally for the great technological advances of tomorrow. Past advances in technology, such as cellular networks and improvements in digital transmission techniques, have led to vastly improved efficiency in spectrum use. And so, consistent with our focus on maximizing the efficient use of spectrum, we're also beginning an inquiry on how we can spur new technologies that share spectrum dynamically. Today, spectrum that is allocated can sit idle during time periods when the primary licensee is not using the airwaves, same for geographic locations. This doesn't make sense given the growing demands on spectrum. The goal for this proceeding is to be a vehicle for identifying steps we can take to unleash and accelerate new spectrum efficiency policies and technologies. I'm interested in ideas, for example, to jumpstart secondary markets for dynamic spectrum access, femtocells, as has been mentioned, spot spectrum sales and transactions. I'm interested in how we can encourage better information on spectrum use, building on our innovative spectrum dashboard and concretely facilitating opportunistic spectrum uses, what some are starting to call auxiliary spectrum uses. Historically, the U.S. has led the world in spectrum policy innovation. Auctions are one example. Auctions of licensed spectrum and release of unlicensed spectrum. Those are two key examples of groundbreaking spectrum policy innovation that was developed and implemented in the United States. I believe incentive auctions are a third major spectrum policy innovation. And I'd like to set a goal for this proceeding, that it lead to yet another historically significant spectrum policy innovation. I'd like to call for broad participation in helping us meet that goal from all of the stakeholders who have an interest in seeing that succeed, traditional innovators who have participated in our processes, but also a new generation of innovators who are looking at spectrum for the first time as a platform for the next generation of innovative technologies, consumer products, medical products, energy products, etc. I don't assume that the spectrum management models and policies used today are those that will make the most sense tomorrow, especially given rapidly evolving technologies, both involving dynamic information-based markets and evolving spectrum sensing devices. I think the opportunity here is not only for the development of new spectrum-efficient policies, as important as that is, but also for us to help spur the development of new spectrum-efficient technologies and products, which we would like to see developed, perfected, launched here in the United States, and then exported to the rest of the world. The spectrum proceedings today are all vital parts of ensuring that the U.S. lead the world in mobile in the 21st century, promoting economic growth, job creation, and our global competitiveness. Julie, you mentioned as you were reciting the names of the people who participated and helped develop these items that it was done with a little bit of help from our friends. Yes, the Beatles are on iTunes, now available on the iPads that we're all purchasing, and other tablets as well. But I do want to thank all of the staff who have worked on this, from the Wireless Bureau and OET and OGC and everyone else. Others have mentioned Doug Sicker. I don't know if Doug is in the room. Doug is our a relatively new CTO here now for a few months on travel, but fulfilling his role in exactly the way that we would hope, coming in from the outside, spurring new thinking, being a bridge to new engineers, other technologists outside the commission. So again, I'm enthusiastic, as we all are, about the directions launched by these proceedings, and I look forward to working with my colleagues, to working with all of you, to turn these ideas into major policy innovations for our country, and seeing the next wave of innovative products relying on spectrum. So again, thank you. And unless there's any more discussion, let's proceed to a vote on each of the items. We'll take two votes. On the first item, the experimental licensing item, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. The ayes have it, so ordered, and the request for editorial privileges is granted. On the second item, for opportunistic use, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. The ayes have it, so ordered. The request for editorial privileges is granted. And again, thank you very much. Madam Secretary.
Okay.
Please introduce.
Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, the final item on your agenda is a presentation with an overview of the 21st Century Communications and Video Accessibility Act, the Commission's implementation plans, and a demonstration of accessibility technologies.
Chairman and commissioners. Today you're going to hear from the Consumer and Governmental Affairs Bureau about a major new initiative. The 21st Century Communications and Video Accessibility Act takes historic steps to improve communications access for people with disabilities, and the FCC has the major responsibility for implementing this act. This act will do more for the communications needs of people with disabilities than any law since the 1996 amendments to the Communications Act. In addition to ensuring full broadband access, it will fill accessibility gaps that were left by earlier disability laws. The National Broadband Plan recommended this kind of legislation, and we are now implementing that recommendation. We're fortunate to have two national leaders in the field in the Consumer Bureau to lead this effort. Greg Leibach is the new chief of the Disability Rights Office housed in the Consumer Bureau. Greg began his career as an activist at Gallaudet University, where he successfully led the student movement for a deaf president at Gallaudet. He has served as an attorney in DRO for nearly a decade, and we are very pleased that he will now lead that office. Karen Peltz-Strauss rejoined the commission earlier this year as deputy chief of the Consumer and Governmental Affairs Bureau, with a special focus on disability rights. She has been a leading national advocate in this field and literally wrote the book, it's a book titled A New Civil Right, that chronicles the legal effort to provide better communications access for people with disabilities. Karen will describe the Act's requirements and the Commission's implementation plan, and then Larry Goldberg, who joins us from WGBH in Boston, will then introduce some of the new technologies that the Act will put into use. I want to thank everyone around the Commission for the hard work that they've already begun to implement this new law. In implementing this Act and in the other work that we're doing on disability rights issues, we are joined by every other bureau and several offices at the FCC. We're grateful and very appreciative for their collaboration and work on these issues. And now I'd like to turn to Greg to begin the presentation. Greg.
Thank you, Chairman Jenikowski. Commissioners, and Joel. It is really a pleasure for me to appear here today in my new role as the Chief of the Disability Rights Office. We can go ahead and begin the slides. Thank you. The 21st Century Act was passed by Congress to update our nation's telecommunications protections for people with disabilities. This act follows a string of laws passed in the 1980s and 1990s. Those laws were designed to ensure that telephone and television access, services would be accessible to all Americans with disabilities. But these laws were not able to keep up with the fast-paced technological changes that our society has witnessed over the past decade. This new law contains groundbreaking protections to enable people with disabilities to access broadband, digital, and mobile innovations. the emerging 21st century technologies for which the act is named. There are approximately 36 million deaf and hard of hearing Americans and 25 million with significant vision loss. In 2009, a study conducted by the FCC revealed that people with disabilities are less likely to use internet-based communications. 65% of Americans have broadband at home, but only 42% of Americans with disabilities have these services. This gap is due in part to barriers that people with disabilities confront when using the internet. It is for this reason that the National Broadband Plan, adopted by the Commission in March of this year, recommended that Congress and the FCC modernize accessibility laws to keep pace with broadband technologies. The new law enables us to fulfill this recommendation.
Here today to talk to you about the accessibility legislation. For people with disabilities, broadband and digital technologies can provide wonderful new opportunities for greater independence and social integration, but only if these innovations are designed to be accessible. The 21st Century Act will provide the tools that these people need to better participate in employment, education, and civic life. It will also encourage innovation and competition across the communication and video programming industries as companies strive to compete for new market shares within the disability community. The Act is divided into two titles. The first, which addresses communications access, expands upon Section 255 of the Communications Act to make products and services using broadband fully accessible to people with disabilities. This requires access to VoIP offerings, electronic messaging, and interoperable video conferencing. In addition, this section requires internet browsers on smartphones and other mobile devices, such as those discussed earlier this morning, to be accessible by people who are blind or visually impaired, so that these persons can use devices to find online information, local services, or news in the same way that sighted people can. Manufacturers and service providers may fulfill this obligation through either integrated or external hardware or software solutions. Title I also requires smartphones and other advanced mobile devices to be compatible with hearing aids. It also updates the definition of relay services and requires all VoIP providers to contribute to the Telecommunications Relay Fund. In addition, the new law authorizes funding to distribute telecommunications equipment to people who are both deaf and blind, the first time ever that federal policy has addressed the communication needs of these individuals. Finally, the law under this title gives the FCC to ensure that people with disabilities are able to use the next generation of 911 emergency services. Title I also directs the Commission to create a clearinghouse of accessible products and services. It directs us to improve the FCC's complaint procedures as well, so that people with disabilities can bring their concerns to our attention more easily. We will also have to be submitting biennial reports to Congress that report on our own compliance with the Act and the accessibility of new communication technologies. And every 5 years, the Comptroller General will report to Congress on how well we have complied with and enforced this new law. Title II of the 21st Century Act breaks new ground to make it easier for people with disabilities to view video programming on television and the internet. First, this section directs the Commission to adopt rules requiring video description of 50 hours of programming per week on each of the top 4 broadcast networks and the top 5 cable networks. This technology uses narration to enable blind and visually impaired people to understand the visual elements of a program during gaps in the audio track. This title also requires that programs shown on television with captions continue to include those captions when they're reshown on the internet. Most importantly, Title II requires emergency information on television to be provided in a manner that is accessible to people who are blind and visually impaired. Until now, emergency information that breaks into regularly scheduled television shows only appears in a crawl on the bottom of the TV screen, which of course blind people cannot read. This measure will assure that blind people have access to this critical information. Title II contains provisions to extend captioning to devices beyond standard television sets. Video devices of all screen sizes, including computers and smartphones, will now be required to display closed captions, if achievable, again, making use of the new technologies that we talked about this morning. The legislation also makes it easier for people who are deaf or blind to use newer video devices as they are developed. For people who have hearing loss, these devices will have to include buttons, keys, or icons that make it easier for users to use captions, to activate captions. And for people who are blind or visually impaired, the Act will make it possible to navigate the controls on their TVs and DVRs, including controls for changing channels, accessing video description, and exploring on-screen programming guides and menus. Right now, these on-screen controls are virtually impossible to use without sight. In the short time since the law's passage, the Commission has sought feedback on the Act's provisions dealing with advanced communication services, hearing aid compatibility, the National Deafblind Equipment Distribution Program, and the two advisory committees that we must create to meet our obligations. The first of these committees is the Video Programming and Emergency Access Committee, which will address various requirements for captioning, video description, and emergency access. And the second is the Emergency Access Advisory Committee, which will work to ensure access to next-generation 911 services. The final slide shows some of the statute's implementation deadlines. In 2011, we will promulgate rules on the Deafblind Equipment Distribution Program, Advanced Communication Services, Hearing Aid Compatibility, and various relay service modifications. This will be followed in 2012 with rules requiring closed captioning on certain internet programs and closed captioning capability on video devices. Finally, in 2013, we will issue several orders to make communications, video programming, and emergency access on television more accessible to people who are blind and visually impaired. There is a lot to be done, but we are very energized by the challenges ahead. The new law is unprecedented in its capacity to offer new communication tools that people with disabilities need to live independent, productive lives. We thank the various bureaus throughout the Commission that have agreed to work on the rulemakings now before us and look forward to collaborating with consumers and industry to implement this new law. And now I present to you Larry Goldberg, Director of WGBH's National Center for Accessible Media in Boston. Both Larry and WGBH have been leaders in accessible video programming programming technologies for the past several decades. Larry will demonstrate these accessibility solutions that will become more widely available as a result of this landmark legislation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, and Joel, Karen, and Greg for the opportunity to show some of these technologies that are available today and will be promoted and required by the new Act. Though most of us are thoroughly familiar with closed captioning, video description is a lesser known but equally essential service used by people with disabilities to access TV. Video description is defined as recorded narration of key visual elements of a TV program or movie, timed to fit into the gaps in dialogue, and scripted to enable understanding and enjoyment of visual media by people who are blind or visually impaired. Today, video description is available in some movie theaters, on DVDs, online, and on a very small number of television shows. Here's a sample of video description from WGBH's Arthur. Listen for the additional voice in the video.
It's just a silly comic book. Just words and pictures. Okay, here I go.
Arthur takes a deep breath and opens the comic book. With a shudder, he throws it into the air.
Ah! Ugh! And he's the good guy!
Pal growls at the scary book. Later, Arthur dreams that a strong wind blows through the window. The comic book glows, and grotesquely grim Bunny rises out of the pages. He clutches the sleeping Arthur in his giant claws and sniffs him. His red eyes glow.
Cut that out, pal.
The bunny jumps back into the book with Arthur. They land in a bare, bleak canyon. Arthur stretches.
As increasingly complex home media components, began to proliferate over the past decade, consumers who are blind or visually impaired began to lose the ability to control their own viewing environment, even the ability to change channels or know what program is on. With the advent of DTV, the level of complexity increased even more. R&D projects in the U.S., U.K., and elsewhere began building prototypes to enable talking menus of all on-screen controls and information, including electronic program guides. In England, the resulting technology is now available on the market. In the U.S., a grant from the Department of Education enabled WGBH's National Center for Accessible Media to create the following prototype using the open-source MythTV platform. The following clip shows how a blind person can navigate an on-screen programming menu using audio prompts.
Main menu, watch TV, media library, mapped recordings, schedule recordings, TV schedule, program guide. Welcome to the program guide. Currently selected is 5:30 p.m. 3WHO wants to be a millionaire. WGRZ channel 2 news at 5:30. 6:00 p.m. channel 2 news. CKVR A channel Barrie/Toronto A channel news at 6.
And finally, web surfing via mobile devices is becoming increasingly common. TV and video viewing on mobile devices is also becoming more common, especially with the recent launch of the mobile DTV standard and the devices that support it. And in terms of access to mobile media, both BlackBerry and Apple support closed captions on their smartphones. Here's what closed captions look like on an iPhone.
U.S. Treasury Secretary Henry Paulson is meeting this week in Washington, D.C. with Chinese officials to try to reduce tensions over trade. What happens could affect businesses large and small, even 500 miles away in the hills of West Virginia.
1, 2, 3.
What? Come on, Bob, take it over. Hold it now. Come on now.
It's the playoffs. Sherman High versus Polka. It may be an American pastime, but more and more it's played with uniforms and equipment from somewhere else.
Thank you. Those are just a few of the technologies that are readily available today and are ready to be deployed widely.
Excellent. Thank you very much. I'll have comments in a minute, but if there's nothing further, I just want to make sure. Commissioner Copps, if you have any comments?
Well, these are great reports by a group of people who are obviously dedicated to making good and needed things happen. First of all, I want to congratulate Greg on his new position. I'm thrilled that you're there, thankful for everything you have already contributed to the commission, and looking forward to all of the stellar contributions you will make in the future. Thanks to Karen one more time for all of the wealth of experience and creativity and commitment that she brings here. To Joel for his outstanding leadership of the Bureau. You really got a stellar team. I want to thank the chairman for his leadership here in this regard. This is, it seems, several of our meetings we've had items and reports on proceedings of interest to the disabilities communities, and just giving it that level of attention and visibility, I think, has been a tremendous public good, and we all ought to be grateful for your leadership on this. Thanks to Larry for his report and for all the creative and good things you're doing there. I really wanted to hear the end of that story that you showed at the at the beginning. This is Congress and the Commission really meeting their responsibilities, making sure that the protections that were intended for all in a previous generation are there for all of us in the digital age that we're in. It's an area we're in. We can do so much good and create opportunity for people who really ask nothing more than the chance to be fully participating and productive members of our society. So you mentioned at the outset this is a historic act. It's a historic opportunity. I think these have come together here now, and I am thrilled to have you folks working on this, thankful that Congress has underlined the importance and given us a really substantive piece of legislation and also some timelines, which we couldn't ignore if we wanted to, but we welcome and help fashion, I think, some of those timelines, so that's great. Working with the disabilities communities, I think, has been one of the highlights of my years here at the FCC, and I am so happy to see us moving ahead so aggressively at this period of time. So thanks to one and all.
Thank you, Commissioner Copps. Commissioner McDowell?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Joel, and by the way, congratulations to Greg as well. Look forward to working with you more closely. And Karen, and excellent job. And our special guest, Mr. Goldberg, thanks so much for that presentation. That was outstanding. That was a very informative presentation overall. And on numerous occasions, I've recognized that the surest path to America's continued vitality, strength, and vibrancy is through realizing and enabling the contributions and full potential of all of its citizens. Along with my colleagues, I've worked hard to encourage the Commission to do all that it can to foster the development and deployment of communication systems that serve disabled Americans and serve them well. Thank you for introducing us to some of these amazing technologies that have already been created to assist people with their communications needs, and I look forward to seeing more of those and learning more about them. In this field in particular, America has been a leader in producing such innovation, and I look forward to working with the disabled community, with engineers, brilliant engineers, entrepreneurs, innovators, and of course my colleagues, to ensure that research and development continues to flourish in this arena as we implement the new act. And I want to thank Congress for passing that as well. So thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the opportunity to say something.
Commissioner Clyburn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would like to welcome Gregory, and I call you Gregory because I'm not sure how to pronounce your last name. thanks also to Karen and Joel for always informing and remaining enthusiastic about an area, in particular areas that we should be enthusiastic about. I had the opportunity to join many of my colleagues when the President signed this bill into law. And I thought I had a handle on exactly what it meant. I knew it was an incredible day. Stevie Wonder was there, so it was incredible in a whole host of ways. But I thought I had a grasp on it until Larry gave his presentation about the potential, about how, what that NOW Act can mean for the enhancement of individuals in terms of entertainment and other information, vital strategic information and services. I am even more enthused about the potential of what we have in store for our entire nation, and I'm literally almost moved to tears of potential. So thanks to all of you for your role in that, and the best is yet to come. Thank you.
Commissioner Baker?
You know, one of the benefits of being in my seat is that my colleagues have already articulated very well both their thanks and how important the 21st Century Communications and Video Accessibility Act is. The new standards that are set so that Americans with disabilities can better take advantage of broadband, digital and mobile innovations is really meaningful. It's really a much needed step for Americans and make sure that all Americans can benefit from today's and tomorrow's innovation. So I look forward to seeing progress on our implementation, and I thank you very much for the excellent presentation.
Thank you very much. First of all, on behalf of the Commission, Larry Goldberg, thank you for taking your time to come here and prepare and present the presentation. We appreciate your time, and we're grateful for it. What an extraordinary team we have working on these issues. Joel, you presented the backgrounds of Greg and Karen. You didn't present your own. Joel has a background with Consumer Reports in helping bring Consumer Reports online, making it, driving it toward being innovative. And in Joel and Greg and Karen and the others who participated in this, we have really a model of what we've been trying to build in terms of FCC teams to tackle these issues. And someone like Greg Leibach, and Greg, again, I congratulate you on taking over the Disabilities Office. We have someone who both has concrete, hands-on past experience in this area and has almost a decade of experience at the FCC itself. And Karen, we have one of, if not the most prominent leaders and thinkers in the space. In Joel, we have someone from the outside who was new to the Commission and its processes, who's bringing a new perspective to these. This is all extremely important. I'm very proud of this team, and you have a lot of work to do, as we've indicated. I do, Commissioner Copps, thank you for mentioning that disabilities has been and is a priority of all of us at this commission. I appreciate that. I want to acknowledge my father in inspiring my own recognition of the needs and opportunities in this area. I want to acknowledge the work of Congress in making these ideas law, putting them into a landmark law, the first in many years. It was a bipartisan effort that included the following members of the House and Senate. There were others, but Congressman Markey and Senator Pryor, Chairman Waxman, Senator Rockefeller, Representative Barton and Hutchinson, Chairman Boucher and Kerry, Representative Stern, Senator Ensign. It was an important effort that sets us, for us now, a bar at the Commission that we are taking very seriously. The law means nothing unless we implement it. We have been working on it, Karen, as you've indicated, first in connection with the National Broadband Plan. We made access by people with disabilities a priority and, in fact, discussed, supported, endorsed the provisions that became law in the broadband plan. We're moving on implementation, and I think, let me just point out one reason why this is so important. One of the challenges in this space historically has been that the idea of making technologies accessible to people with disabilities has often come well after the development, design, go-to-market stage of a product. And when that happens, it's very difficult. It's very difficult for everyone involved. We've all participated in meetings where people are looking at each other and saying, yeah, you know, it'd be really good if this technology had this feature that would make it accessible to the millions of people who are disabled, but retrofitting will be expensive and will take a lot of time. And so what's so important about the energy and early focus of this team is that it increases the chances that our rules, our work with industry can happen at a stage where the costs of making technologies accessible as is required is vastly reduced, and so that we can all together accomplish more faster. And so that's why I'm so pleased with the presentation today. I'm pleased that since the adoption of the law, we've issued several notices, and I know you've conducted many meetings and a lot of outreach to move the ball. We'll be making an announcement very soon with respect to two advisory committees that the law requires. One is an advisory committee on emergency access, the other on video programming. We have a lot of work to do to meet the deadlines in the Act. This will remain an ongoing priority, one, because of its inherent importance, and two, because of the value we can add by moving quickly and engaging with innovators, manufacturers, and others early in the rollout of new technologies. This does not require a vote. I will simply thank everyone again very much on behalf of all of us on the commission. With that, you are free to go. I think we're going to conclude the meeting. I have one announcement. Does anyone? Please go ahead.
Some may have noticed that the COPS office team has not been at full complement for the last 6 days, and that's because our friend Josh Sinelli and his wife Hannah became parents on the day before Thanksgiving, and we join in their joy in welcoming little Ezra Giles Sinelli, who was born last Wednesday. So it was a wonderful Thanksgiving there, and Josh reports that the Ezra is sleeping well and eating well, and that Josh and Hannah spend most of their time just kind of deliriously staring at this wonderful little boy that they have created. So we are very happy for him and Hannah and Ezra.
Commissioner Clyburn, please.
I don't have an announcement, but thank you for yielding for a second. I had the opportunity to attend the Global Symposium for Regulators in Senegal not long ago. The only regret I have is that that prevented me from attending NARUC. I say that, but I'm not sure if my colleagues missed me, because my colleague, Commissioner Copps, did such a wonderful job chairing the joint boards and conferences. I want to publicly thank you for that. I heard you ended the meeting on time. It's going to be difficult for me to return to my post, because they're going to have that expectation and they won't get it. So seriously, I want to thank you for stepping in and doing such a marvelous job for that. Thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner Clyburn. Commissioner Baker, nothing? I have one. First of all, on NARUC, I did get to go to NARUC. I was very pleased to do that. NARUC felt like home, since we have Commissioner Clyburn, you here, and Sharon Gillette as well. I do want to thank Commissioner Copps and Commissioner Clyburn, both of you, for playing the roles that you do on the joint board. Commissioner McDowell, Commissioner Baker. I Commissioner McDowell. Your turn will come. But it's a very important part of what we do. Federal-state relations are very important. It really does take a lot of work, and I thank and acknowledge the three of you for doing that. And it was good for me to see it in person in Atlanta and NARUC. Let me take this moment to say goodbye to a very valuable member of our team who is leaving the commission, Phoebe Young. I don't know if Phoebe is here. Phoebe is here. I've now embarrassed her in front of everyone. We all took a break last week to say thanks for the many things that we all have to be grateful for. One of the things that that I personally, and I know we're all very grateful for, is to have had Phoebe as a member of our FCC team. Since last summer, Phoebe has served as my senior advisor for broadband. She's one of the key architects of the National Broadband Plan, a model for strategic planning for our nation and the world. When we released the National Broadband Plan in March, we said that that's when the real work begins. And Phoebe has been the main person leading the plan's implementation since its release, establishing an ambitious action agenda, managing its execution. Phoebe, you've done an outstanding job working not only with each of our bureaus and offices to drive initiatives like modernizing E-rate and our rural health program, but also with partners across government to ensure that the full panoply of recommendations in the plan get the attention and focus they deserve. We could not have made the progress we've made on broadband without Phoebe. Critical to have a key member of the broadband team stay on past February, drive implementation of the plan, working, as I said, with the bureaus and offices, with my office, and with each of our offices on the eighth floor. Phoebe brought to the job a remarkable combination of skills, broad strategic thinking, effective management, Phoebe, I know you'll thrive in your new position at the advisory board, where you'll continue to work on education and other issues. We've all benefited greatly from your extraordinary talents and abilities. We've learned from your integrity, your team building. We will miss you. On behalf of all of us at the Commission, I thank you for your service, and we wish you well. And with that, if there are no other comments, I know I speak on behalf of all of my commissioners in thanking Phoebe. And with that, Madam Secretary, would you please announce the date of the next FCC meeting?
The next agenda meeting of the Federal Communications Commission will be Tuesday, December 21st, 2010.
Thank you. We are adjourned.
Dealing with regarding the first item you dealt with today, as you know, the broadband plan talks about a voluntary reallocation of 120 megahertz. There's still been a lot of skepticism among some broadcasters about whether this will work in practice, whether the technology will allow it. Can you address their continued skepticism over this plan?
Well, I think incentive auctions, voluntary incentive auctions, are very important for the reasons I talked about in the meeting today. We're facing a real spectrum crunch. You've heard me in the past talk about the numbers, the gap between the supply of spectrum we have coming online, about 2.5x what we have now, as against the demand increase that we project over the next 5 years, 35x. And I feel very strongly that the incentive auction idea is a very important policy innovation that is essential to bring market forces to the use of broadcast spectrum, to free up spectrum, gives broadcasters optionality, as you said. And I'm very pleased that we started the proceeding today to lay the groundwork for incentive auctions, which I hope Congress will address in the near future.
But will you get takers, if you will, in the markets, the large markets, where you'll need spectrum for wireless broadband?
Well, I believe we would. I think that's the beauty of bringing market forces into the use of the spectrum. We'll let market forces help decide how to make sure that spectrum is used in the most efficient way in the future, how it's put to its highest and best use for our country, especially in an area of mobile broadband that's vital to our global competitiveness.
Hi, Chairman. Paul Barbagallo, BNA. Regarding the same item, the steps the FCC proposes to take would presumably open the door to leasing. Assuming there's a delay on the Hill, would a leasing framework be amenable at all as a plan B?
Look, 2 points. One is, in general, spectrum flexibility is smart policy. But there's something that is important in thinking about the broadcast spectrum and the historical way in which it was allocated as against the direction that spectrum allocations have gone, and what's important to unlock the value of spectrum for the future. So broadcast spectrum originally was allocated in 6 megahertz chunks, like a checkerboard across the country with gaps between them. What we hope to do as part of an incentive auction process is recover up to 120 megahertz of spectrum and then work to reconfigure the broadcast spectrum so that we can free up significant contiguous blocks of spectrum, which is what is most needed by mobile broadband, by current and the next generation 4G technologies. So leasing, in general, as I said, I'm for spectrum flexibility and would consider all options to improve spectrum flexibility. But it doesn't come close to providing the same benefits to the public as the incentive auction model and making sure that we have contiguous blocks of spectrum for mobile broadband. That is what other countries are and will focus on. We have to find ways to free up contiguous blocks of spectrum in the United States.
Hi, Katie Bachman, Media Week. This is a simple question. How long do you expect the comment period to be? And second, how would that affect the timing? I mean, obviously, this is very dependent on Congress doing something. So when do you expect Congress to take something like this up, and how do you like your chances that they will?
So the comment period itself, we'll get back to you. I don't remember the comment period, but Bill or someone can answer that question. What was driving our action today, what is driving our action today, was the time pressure that we feel to get out in front of the spectrum crunch. And so the importance of laying the groundwork at the commission to be able to move quickly should Congress authorize incentive auctions. We also believe that the record that we will collect as part of this will be helpful as a resource to Congress as they consider the possibility. I think this is something that has been bipartisan. It should be bipartisan. You see a broad consensus on the commission itself. And so I'm looking forward to being a resource to Congress on this. And I'll continue to emphasize how important this is for the country. One other point that I would make is, like other infrastructure issues, if you wait until there's a crisis, it's a serious problem because it takes a substantial amount of time to go through the process of running an auction, reallocating spectrum, et cetera. That's why we started today. It's also why we took up the other items today. They're complementary, and they're really an ongoing part of our spectrum agenda. We do need to recover a substantial amount of spectrum for flexible use in mobile broadband. We also need to foster, spark, incentivize, facilitate, drive the next generation of spectrum policies and technologies that will lead to even greater spectrum efficiency and take advantage of cutting-edge technologies that allow for dynamic uses of spectrum, et cetera.
When you say this would be a resource for Congress, do you mean to say that this sort of makes it easier for them to say, okay, let's go ahead and do this? I mean, you've all sort of done the work and laid the groundwork. I mean, do you think that'll...
That's not what I meant. I meant that the information we gather and the information that we're already gathering, our work on this, as the expert agency, we look forward to being a resource to Congress on this issue. And so the ongoing proactive work that we're doing is designed both to make sure that we can move quickly if and when legislation is adopted, and also to make sure we're in a position to be an effective resource to Congress, as we have been and we will be.
Okay, so if Congress doesn't do anything, then what?
We only have time for a couple more questions. I'm sorry. Amy?
I have a question.
Go ahead.
Hi, Chairman. Can you tell us about your commitment to net neutrality and whether you're committed to doing it at the next meeting and doing it without reclassifying broadband?
We just came out of a meeting focused on our important spectrum agenda, focused on implementing the new law with respect to people with disabilities. I know that there's interest in the open internet topic, but I'm not going to address it here. When we have something to announce, we'll do so.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure. I just wondered if you were planning on finishing the Comcast NBC review this year, and if that's even possible if you take up net neutrality in December.
We haven't talked, and I don't have comment on the timetable for reviewing the transaction. It's an important obligation to review it thoroughly. And we're in the process of that.
Also, as a follow-up, did you want more information about the Level 3's complaint against Comcast?
You know, that is new information, as you know. It would be premature to comment on it before knowing what the facts are. We're looking into it.
So, but you are looking into it? You're trying
staff
to get more facts?
It.
Okay, thanks.
Would it be possible for the FCC to carry out the national broadband PUN under a Title I net neutrality order?
Again, when we have something to announce on that, we'll let you know.
Yeah. Commissioner McDowell had mentioned weighing the strengths and weaknesses of things like channel sharing and repacking with respect to the TV broadcast spectrum versus, I believe the words he used were, keeping broadband and broadcast interwoven. What do you think about that and that kind of position with regard to the notice that was issued today?
Well, I'll let Commissioner McDowell respond to any questions you have about what he said. The plan for incentive auctions doesn't assume that all over-the-air broadcast spectrum goes away. I mean, to be concrete about it, the plan that was outlined in the National Broadband Plan looks at about 300 megahertz of spectrum that are allocated to broadcasting in every market and sets a goal of recovering up to 120. So under the scenarios that that we're anticipating, that others are anticipating, they'll continue to be vibrant over-the-air broadcasting. And so thinking about all the ways, and you heard it from various commissioners, about the future of over-the-air broadcasting, it's part of the proceeding, something that we will look into. I don't see it as an either-or. I see it as a both.
Okay. All my questions were asked.
Thank you.
Hi, Mr. Chairman. Todd Shields, Bloomberg News. Some people look at the pattern of meetings in your office on the net neutrality proceeding and say you're striking a cozy deal with AT&T and other big carriers. What do you say to that?
Well, I'm proud of the process we've run on the commission. It's been a participatory process engaging with the broadest possible array of stakeholders.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Have a good day.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We'll now proceed to the staff portion of the post-agenda press conference, and Julie Knapp from OET will be here for all three. We'll do that in two phases. We'll first go to the innovation item, and then we'll do the two experimental items as one unit, like the commissioners did. So we start with the innovation item. Well, in fact, we'll start with Katie's question about timing, since that's hanging over from the comment period.
Yeah, the comment period will be 45 days after publication in the Federal Register, and then 30 days after that for replies.
Okay, Paul?
Just, it's a silly question, but you guys generally have been getting stuff out the same day of the meeting. Is it likely the item will be out today? Not holding you to it, but...
Yeah, that's what our objective is
okay.
to have them.
Is that also the expectation for the other two items, the NOI and the NPRM and...
Our plan is to have all three out today.
Thank you.
Hi, Paul Barbagallo, BNA. I had a question specifically about the channel sharing. I know that there has been some concern among the broadcasters about the compression technology currently used. That, you know, most there's some consensus in the industry about MPEG-4. Being a feasible compression scheme, but most are on MPEG-2 right now. Is there anything in the item that contemplates smoothing the transition from MPEG-2 to MPEG-4?
The two things are intertwined there. When we talked in the notice about channel sharing, it's still assuming that ATSC technology that we have today, which is MPEG-2. I think Commissioner McDowell may have raised about MPEG-4, and that would involve a different kind of change fundamentally in the technology.
Okay. Any other questions?
John? Hi, just a couple questions. The channel sharing, proposal, does that envision more than two full power broadcasters sharing one 6 megahertz channel or just two, and I guess how's the question or questions phrased?
Well, as you'd expect in a notice, we talk about channel sharing as two or more. So we ask about what's feasible and what the trade-offs would be. So it's not limited to just two, although, obviously, the more that you add, the more challenge there is in the sharing.
In high VHF, are we talking 10 dB in the proposal, or?
I'm not sure we had a specific. It was six.
Six dB.
Okay. Anything, Jonathan?
Hi. Thank you. That just dovetailed on my other question. I'm sorry. The VHF power increase proposal, just in layman's terms, you're saying it proposes a 6 dB. What's the increase it discusses?
Well, first of all, the focus of this is what can we do going forward to improve VHF reception? And there are trade-offs in increasing power because you have to maintain a balance between stations. So we ask about whether increasing power would be helpful, and we also ask about whether there's things that we can do relative to antennas that would be improve the ability for consumers to get reception.
Follow-up? Yep, just one last question. The presentation did mention antennas. Can you just tell us a little bit more about that? Are these outdoor antenna standards, indoor? Both?
No, I think it was focused on the indoor antennas. And part of the reason for that is the experiences that we drew from the DTV transition. Consumers don't always realize from the markings on the box the ability of an antenna to receive VHF. And sometimes the VHF frequencies, the physics point to a larger antenna, and we all like small antennas. So providing at least better information to consumers about the performance of antennas so they could make informed choices may be something that would be useful to do.
Thank you.
Okay, that concludes item one. Now we'll go to the experiment and dynamic access items. Do you have questions on that before they come up? Any questions on that one? Okay. I was mentioning, I noticed that Joel and Karen are here. Any questions on the 21st century communications disability? Okay, no questions. That concludes the press conference, concludes today's agenda meeting. Thank you.